Matthew McCabe. Welcome to Miracle Voices. Each episode, we will be delving into stories of forgiveness, healing, and transformation that have come about from integrating the principles of the book, A Course in Miracles. If you want to learn more about A Course in Miracles, visit www.acim.org. If you'd like to visit the Miracle Voices site, please go to www.miraclevoices.org. If you feel inspired to make a love offering, please visit us at miraclevoices.org/donate. All donations go to support the work of the Foundation for Inner Peace, the publisher of A Course in Miracles. Now here's your program. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another edition of Miracle Voices. This is your co-host, Matthew McCabe. I'm here with my co-host, Tam Morgan. Tam, how are you doing today?
I am doing well. I'm excited to be with two Matts. And as soon as you introduce Matt, I'll tell you one other thing before we start.
I wish you left that dangling so people would be like, why is she seeing two Matts? And just in
Go for it. Well, if there's still something dangling, go ahead.
Yes. Matt Colomé, welcome to Miracle Voices.
Okay. Before you say anything, Matt, we have Matt Colomé today and Matt Colomby.
Yeah. Oh, gosh. She's here all week, folks. Try the salad bar.
Well, delighted to be here. Thank you, Tam. Thank you, Matt. Just so couldn't be happier and pleased to be able to share, you know, a few minutes with you here in Miracle Voices. Thanks for inviting me.
Sure, our pleasure. And Matt, where are you in the world?
Well, I live in a port in Mexico called Manzanillo. It's on the Pacific coast. It's the most important port relative to imports and exports for the country. So there's a lot of port activity and international trade happening here. So I live here. I work here. Although I am originally from Mexico City, from central Mexico.
Okay, great. So you're a Chilango. Is that the right term?
I am. Yeah, I can see that you have fine domain of Mexican slang, Matt. That congratulations for that.
What does that mean? I'm left out. I have no Mexican slang. Well,
Chilango is like the slang word for somebody who is from Mexico City.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And since, you know, us city people, when you go out of the city, you're not necessarily looked at like, you know, the most popular person, because they tend to not like city people. So that's where the Chilango term comes in. Oh, he's a Chilango or something like this guy, you know. He's not one of us, but
yeah, they talk faster. They're a little more aggressive. Yeah. It's kind of like New Yorkers.
Yeah. Exactly. I know it well. Okay.
Well, Matt, please tell us how A Course in Miracles came into your life.
Well, thank you. Be delighted. This was back in 2017. I was going through a tough moment in my life. I was having a personal and financial meltdown. Essentially, that's what was happening to me. I had started a consulting firm. You know, I've been working for 33 years, mechanical engineer. And I started, I had a startup consultancy with a couple of partners that didn't actually meet the thresholds of performance. And hence, my whole situation, my whole financial situation. Let me not get into the details of that, but I began to melt down financially and personally. And I saw myself losing, you know, my savings, my house. Back then, I had a couple of properties. The whole thing was endangered. I was estranged from my kids, which, you know, are grown kids by now. And a friend came over and gave me the book that not only saved me then, but has actually changed my life completely, entirely. I mean, the way I see life is is completely different. And I'm so forever, I will always be forever thankful to this person. And I now know that it's really the Holy Spirit who's there, you know, who's in us and just came and knocked on my door. I was baffled and dumbfounded by the fact that book had been dictated to somebody and had been written. I mean, that fact alone just you know, knocked me off my feet. It's like, how could that ever happen? And then looking into the book, I mean, it became something that I just got instantly immersed into. Like an instruction manual that I was waiting for all my life. So that's how I came in touch with it, with A Course in Miracles.
Were you put off at all by the language and how it's written, or were you able to dive right in and accept it and understand it?
That's a good question, Matt. Yeah. I had it delivered to me in Spanish, so it's a translation. Yes. And, you know, luckily, I'm fully bilingual, and you know, went to the internet site of a, you know, Foundation for Inner Peace, and I was able to kind of match the English version with the Spanish version. And yeah, at first, you know, the language did you know, it was hard at times to fully grasp and understand. And I felt the density of it, but it's not a density that's like associated with boredom or something like that. It's density because of depth and content. So that on one hand, it pulled my attention strongly, but on the other made it tough, you know, to really grasp and understand. So it was a challenge, you know, and a challenge that I started and got myself endeavored into personally. And completely alone, with no help from anybody, or else because the person that gave the book to me wasn't doing the course herself, so she just had, you know, taken a look at it and thought it was a cool idea to give me the book. So essentially, it was I who alone dove into the content from day one. And up until this day, I have read the full book 3 times, completely, from A to Z, from page one to page last.
That is impressive.
Thank you, yes. Tam. And not only that, but I've underlined it, okay, every time. And every read, out of the 3 rounds, I used a different color of highlighter. Mm. So it's orange, it's blue, and it's yellow. And I can see, you know,
that the Spanish one.
I really can't believe I'm so appreciative of this happening, because I had never told anyone this. You know? And it's so important in my life. Yeah. So important. Yeah.
Is that the Spanish one that you've underlined 3 times?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So now I challenge you, read the English one.
Exactly. I will get it, because it is a challenge that I had thought of. You know, I should get the English version book, because the web-based app, etc., it's good for a little read and it's good for the day's exercise maybe, but right. It's not the same feeling as the book. Yeah. I like the book. I have carried that book, you know, through thick and thin. I made it a cover, you know, so that it wouldn't get worn out or anything. And I've traveled the world with it, you know, always so heavy in my backpack, almost mm-hmm. always. Right now, it's not there because I had to empty my backpack recently, but I still have it right by my bedside. Yeah.
Wonderful. Okay, yeah, get back to me after you compare the two, because your English is beautiful.
Thank you so much, Tom. Appreciate that.
I'm always interested in a deeply studied course student and them seeing if there's, you know, differences or similarities in the language and in the feel of the translations.
Yes, absolutely.
The translations are ever evolving. They're ever evolving. And, you know, the deeper the translator gets involved, then that's when we have the revisions over and over again. And that's why, because it's, you know, it's such a living document and it keeps going to a deeper level as we get to a deeper level. So,
exactly.
Anyway,
exactly.
That's quite a challenge as an invitation.
Yeah.
I'm softening it.
Thank you. Appreciate it. And I will do it. And I hope I can come back to you and say, look, you know, I have these few findings here, you know, key differences.
Love it.
Yeah.
Love it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Well, Matt, would you like to tell us more about your forgiveness story?
Well, sure. Sure. I think, you know, the big forgiveness topic is essential to me. Let me just share a little bit about my upbringing and childhood. Okay. I was born in Mexico City. My family did pretty well. My father was a civil engineer, and he was very successful by the time I was born. I had four older siblings. The closest to me was an 11-year-old boy, then a 12-year-old girl, and a 16-year-old brother, and then my eldest sister, 21 years older than I. So, you know, you could judge that, you know, from it had been 11 years since my parents hadn't had any other baby. So the factory was pretty much closed, right? But but I came about and my mother passed away when I was given birth. So I was an orphan right there from the start. I was taken care of by my eldest sister in part because she eventually married and, you know, left home. And then I had a number of, you know, outsourced nannies to take care of me, even some imported from Europe, amazingly. And it was very chaotic, experience, not only for my family, etc. And this, why am I saying this in lieu of forgiveness? Because I remember myself, well, being, you know, a small kid trying to understand the world, saying, where's my mom? And the answer I got was, God took her away. She's with God, you know? And of course, immediately you'd say, why? I mean, why did God take my mom away? I mean, it's, you know, because I was seeing all my peers and mates and, you know, et cetera, school, and everybody had a mom. I didn't. It was obvious. Everybody knew it. You know, it was supposedly a secret, but everybody knew it. Of course, every single one of my grade school mates, with whom I'm still in contact, by the way, luckily, thank God, they knew. You know, and you know, I had the duty, like, you know, years after, of going back and saying, "Hey, do I need to forgive God for taking my mom away?" I mean, this was a medical malpractice, what happened, essentially. That's why my mother passed away. Which you know, this is back in 1965 I'm talking about. Now, today, the likelihood of that happening is so very low. I've never come across somebody that has gone through the same thing. Never. Somebody who lost the mother, you know, at birth and never saw the mother, or never heard her voice, or et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that was my first forgiveness task. You know, it's like, forgive God. But how could one forgive God? God gave me life. You know, it's puzzling, right? And of course, you know, I grew up pretty, you know, as any normal kid would. But of course, I thought I required a bit more help, maybe, because I had problems relating with the opposite sex, you know, with girls, and then eventually I got married, and it was a disaster, and et cetera, et cetera. It wasn't a happy story, and you know, I used to spend hours and hours of therapy, you know, paying the very expensive therapists, trying to see what I needed to do in order to be normal, you know, in order to fill the gap that my absent mother left, maybe. And this is all maybes, because this is all intangible, right? What? Right. So, I guess, you know, like I was saying to you, Matt, when we spoke earlier, the big forgiveness is forgiving myself for being so hard on myself, right? For making hard choices, for probably not understanding myself as much as I would have needed to in order to have a more peaceful life. But of course, there came the moment when, you know, my eyes were open, and I do know today that nothing real can be challenged, right? Hey, yeah, that's so refreshing for me to know that nothing real can be threatened. Oh my God, I think that's in the first page of the book. I think the very first page says that. I don't have it here with me. But that's,
yes.
You know, so it became something like, hey, I want to see life through the course, because I really needed help. I mean, I wasn't a suicidal person. I wasn't a particularly destructive or self-destructive person. But what I do know is that I did suffer a lot. I didn't have a good time. I didn't have a happy childhood. I wasn't happy at all with my upbringing, in spite of having everything, materially speaking. But nonetheless, I wasn't a happy kid. And back then, there was very little culture about, you know, hey, this kid may benefit from going to therapy. No. So I had to do all that stuff, you know, as years went on, to no avail, or to no great progress. Until I bump with the, you know, the course. So, for instance, you know, right now I need to. I live in Manzanillo, as I was telling you. I'm responsible for a port operation. Let's call it. Do I like it? I'm not particularly sure. Would I prefer to be somewhere else? Yeah. Would I, you know, what makes me be here? Well, a series of bad decisions in my life and moments that, you know, in which I was either confused or either looking for love in all the wrong places and not finding it or something like that. But the fact is that I have plenty of responsibility. I have 4 children to take care of, which I have since they were born, you know. And that continues to be a challenge for me. And that's one of the reasons why I live in a place like the one I live in. And I do this while I would much rather be doing something else, because I did find something that fulfilled me. See, that's part of the fun story that happened along when I came across A Course in Miracles. My life began to change so very much back in those years, so much, and one of the things that changed was a discovery I made. I did discover something that actually I can call today is my passion, and I was, you know, 53 years old. I mean, it was late in the game, so I had already spent so many years, you know, in as I've heard Tam say several times, the hamster wheel. Yeah, that hamster wheel that had lasted so many years. I mean, just doing something that has no depth or true importance. Not just doing it because I need to support kids. I need to pay tuitions. I need to pay a mortgage. I need to pay my, you know, I need to get by. And at 53, I found my passion. So it was a beautiful combination of a new way of seeing the world. Because, you know, that's one of the promises from the course, right? To get away from fear. Oh, God, that's music to my ears. Am I the only one? Look around. And is anybody else interested in, you know, doing without your fears? It's like, yeah. Well, that did ring and continues to ring many, many bells inside, you know. That's the thing I appreciate. I really appreciate. And the other thing I really appreciate from the course is those things that are explained in the very beginning, that Helen and Bill, while putting it together and while being called upon to do this write up, they were looking for a different way, right? Mm-hmm. A different way. I'm surrounded by family members who are either have been, you know, hospitalized because of addictions, because of whatever you name it, whatever crisis, whatever, et cetera, et cetera. There's got to be another way. There's got to be another way. This is the other way. You see, nothing real can be challenged. Nothing real can be threatened. Okay, so that tells me that whatever it is I'm thinking, whatever it is that my ego is putting together for me this morning as means of a collage for me to look at, is not real. And that what is real will be there in spite of what my ego says or does for me. So that's a great relief for me. So going back to the forgiveness line, et cetera, I find my passion. I find that... It's amazing. I just love this opportunity to share this with you. I can sing really well. And I can sing really well in English. So I discover that when I'm 53 years old by some dumb initiative. Hey, let's do something different in the weekend. And I'm going to sign up in this singing school that's really across from the neighborhood in which I have a summer house. And that's how I began to feel all these things while singing swing in English, not in Spanish, in English, you know, Sinatra, Dean Martin, you know, Nat King Cole, all that. I couldn't believe that. And I got better and better and really, really quick to a point in which my teacher said, I can't hold you here any longer. You need to step up. I began really enjoying it and saying, I used to sit down and cry out of satisfaction, something that had never in my life happened to me. Never, ever had that happened to me. Please sit down. And I would spend 5 minutes crying of happiness. What's this? Oh, my God. So, you know, all these life-changing ingredients were there, you know, and I thought, well, you know, this starts looking like something that I'm going to do professionally, you know, because I did have a presentation and a launch with a big band, you know, 25 musicians and a chorus. I even wrote a book about it, which, by the way, it's in Amazon, about this, about finding your passion in life, which I did by chance. And of course, with a new vision of the world and life based on A Course in Miracles. So I was really, really happy then. I was really looking at a different life. And that's when COVID hit, you know. So I had all these presentations booked. I had hired a PR firm, social media, you know, all these mini videos being produced, audition here, audition there. I was so thrilled because by then I had finished my country chairman role for a multinational firm that operated also in Mexico. That firm had merged with another, and all the management team was let go, including myself. So that also happened at the same time. So it's like, hey, all the stars are aligning for this to happen. And then COVID hits. So essentially all my plans for becoming a swing, you know, crooner, Sinatra type, etc., which there's a huge market for, which there's an audience, people appreciate it. It's beautiful, love music, love-related music always. I mean, it's so nice and solid. It went all to shambles, you know, because of COVID. Everybody got locked in. So no shows, no dates, no nothing. And all my idea of becoming a different person was destroyed, you know, because of course, you know, my savings started running out and I still have to pay tuitions. I still have to pay, you know, college educations. I have 3 kids that are going through college in private universities in Mexico, which are very expensive. had to go back and get into this life train that I was so happy departing from and leaving behind. I had a vocal coach that while singing My Way, he'd tell me, hey, you know, put on all the feeling that you're leaving all that working life behind. Okay. Sing it there with My Way. Well, and I did. And I used to cry doing it. And people around me would cry hearing me. And it was huge. You know, I found out, one of my sisters told me, well, it's so funny that you have become a singer and that you can sing those tunes so well in English, because those were the exact tunes that mom used to hear when she was pregnant with you. Wow. Was that the case? Yeah. So it all came like down on me in a very short period of time, relatively speaking, you know. So it was, hey, this new life. And of course, I was an avid reader, and lesson after lesson, and the textbook, and I was so rigorous, and so I found so much solace in the fact that it is an illusion that we're separated from our Creator. It's an illusion. Now, it's so hard at times to believe that, because we're still in this dimension, you know, in this, you know, space-time dimension that we haven't transitioned over to integrity, you know. The atonement hasn't at least happened for me, although, you know, one of the things that I love but still don't really understand is the Course makes several references to a journey that should have never began or that should have never happened. Wow, what? In what part of that journey that never happened am I? It's like, but I see that, and it's complex, but I like it. And it gives me energy, and it gives me a will to live differently. So going back to forgiveness, you know, I've recently had to forgive myself, saying, oh, why did I make these wrong choices, you know, about career, etc., getting involved with, you know, the wrong people, or probably, you know, not the best of people, for having kids with, and having myself go through such an expensive life train, all these obligations that I did acquire on my own. I mean, nobody forced me at gunpoint. No, I and now I can't get out of it. I want, you know, I'm at a point in my life in which I'm, you know, 57 years old, almost 58. I'm seeing the best years of my life going past me. And let's say that I am not in the ideal job today. I do interact with a lot of people. Yeah. But it's just so amazing, the prayer that Tam was saying earlier. The Holy Spirit has me where I should be, where I need to be. I need to be here. And every morning I keep repeating myself that. There's got to be a reason. It's about the interaction. There's people here that I interact with. Maybe a few words that I can say that shed a small ray of light into their hearts. That's more powerful than fulfilling my, you know, desire to be the Mexican crooner, recognized, et cetera, et cetera. It's tough, I'll tell you that. Huh? It's tough. And when the weekend comes and I still sing, of course, I, you know, not like in the beginning, not that I think I even sing better now than I did 3 years ago or 4 years ago. But the feeling is different. The feeling is, this is a hobby. I now work here, and I have to use a lot of forgiveness. I have to forgive myself for all this, for all this mess. Probably forgive myself for all the guilt I carried of being like the inescapable cause of a family disaster that, of course, wasn't meant or provoked in any way by myself. But I was the living proof that a tragedy had happened. Mom is not here, and there you are. Oh, my God. You know, there's got to be some forgiveness here, some form of a macro forgiveness. And that's another thing I really love about the Course, the atonement. Oh, my God, such a beautiful word. the word itself just knocks me off my feet. And just thinking about it, it's just like, yeah, that's what we need, don't we? Because it's a chain of events, and it's all of us together. And all the reference that the course makes on your brother, yeah. That's what I mean. You know, we probably an interaction with all these brothers that we come across on a daily basis has cosmic significance that we can't see because of our egos, because of our you know, desire to feel and be separated, which in fact we're not, but it's an illusion. And coming to terms with all that, must say it's complex. But at the same time, I feel that I'm accompanied, if you like, that there's something there that, given the complexity, I'm not scared by the complexity. I see so many people so scared on their spirituality, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not. I am not. I know where my spirituality is. It's right there in that book. That's my spirituality. I don't need anything else. I don't need to go to seminars or go spend a week here. It'd be nice because I have to work every single day and take a bit of vacation here and there to run errands, essentially. But I think it has all the power in the universe to change a life. And as it also says, with one person that can you know, do the change, that can really, really understand or you know, reach a certain level of knowledge and understanding that can be conveyed to our brothers, that's enough. I mean, I have heard several times Tam speak in your podcast saying you don't need a lot of effort, because the course also says you don't need a lot. I mean, you don't need to turn into something different, turn into some guru of some kind that'd be scary. Like, because I have four children, for Christ's sakes, I need to get them through college. I mean, I have to work. I have to. So I'm not going to turn into anything different. I think I must comply with my direct, immediate obligations first and foremost, right? But at the same time, put that in context. In the context of us all, there's no moral superiority from anybody. You know, nobody's life has higher value than anybody else's. I mean, we all have one value. It's the same. I probably have spoken a little bit too long.
No. Don't worry about that.
No, but I will say, Matt Colomé, you better ask a question if you want now, because I have a bunch lined up.
Okay. I love it, Tam. I love it. Thank you. I'm enjoying it so much.
Yeah, that is.
Well, I'm gonna give the opportunity for me not to jump in right away, because I do have a bunch of questions.
Yeah, you know, one thing you and I talked earlier, Matt, and I didn't want to forget about this, how you describe forgiveness like a button that you have to hold down. Can you just mention that? Because I think it's so helpful.
Sure, man. I mean, it's the ever constant presence of our egos trying to sabotage my views, et cetera, et cetera. So what I meant by pushing that button and keeping it pushed is always being in that mood of forgiveness. Because there are grievances. Grievances happen on a daily basis. I mean, you know, from somebody pulling in on your car, driving to work, from some colleague, you know, stepping over or you know, talking louder than you on a meeting, or you know, teeny tiny grievances here, there, everywhere. It's that forgiveness mode. It's that button that needs to be pushed and kept pushed. And keeping it pushed means staying within a view that there's a likelihood for deviation. And that's why the course, that's the way I understand it. That's why the lessons are recommended that twice a day for 10 minutes, twice, three times a day, morning. Yeah, because, you know, the course, the Holy Spirit knows that you'll be deviated, but in essence, it's always there. The Holy Spirit's always there, always there. So you want to push the button. It's forgiveness mode, and there's nothing that can't be forgiven when in that mode, if you like.
Yeah. And the default position of the button is to be unpushed. So you can't put anything on it. You have to choose to be pushing the button to feel that forgiveness. That's such a wonderful way of looking at it.
Exactly. Yes. Exactly.
Go ahead, Tam.
Yeah. Okay. Well, as far as pushing the button, I mean, it just reminds me of when I felt, and I've said this before, that I was, you know, the most controlling person on earth, and please, please take that control away from me. And instead, I saw these two buttons, a blue one that was peace and a red one that was war. And I was told that it was always my choice, that my control aspect would be used 100% in my life to know that I could always control which button I chose at any given moment. And it allowed me to really understand, you know, the lesson, particularly if I could see peace instead of this, I could push that button instead of the war button. And it was helpful to me because it got me out of the fight with my own controlling aspect. And just that, I love the image of just holding that button down continuously.
Yes.
Not even like making a choice throughout my day, just like holding the peace button down. And so
for that, don't let go. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I have one just Tam curious question, which was, what was the malpractice? What was the thing that happened with your mother? With my mother, I know when she was giving birth to my brother, they weren't paying attention to her head. They were paying attention to her lower parts, and she aspirated. She had a, you know, back then they gave you, I think, ether as an anesthetic, and she threw up in the gas mask, and they didn't realize she aspirated the vomit into her lungs and had pneumonia for 6 weeks, couldn't hold her baby. She was in the hospital. And I was just, that curiosity brought me to what kind of malpractice happened with your mother.
Sure. Thanks, Tam. You know, it's part of the mystery that I have been living relative to my mother is it created such pain and such chaos that it became a true mystery. So for me, to get an accurate idea as to what had happened took me many years. And it wasn't something like, you know, straightforward, like diagnose this. I got bits and pieces, you know, of certain angles of the whole thing, you know. First thing that happened, my mother chose a small maternity clinic instead of a full-blown hospital. Mm-hmm. So while having these complications in that tiny clinic, there was a huge hemorrhage, and it couldn't be stopped, and there was no blood bank to replace the blood that my mother was losing, and essentially that is what caused her death. As I know, I'll probably never know because my father would be the guy who he was so absolutely close and secretive and just don't go there, created so much suffering, etc. That it wasn't even a topic. You know? Mm-hmm. I learned through an aunt and this is the other second part of the diagnosis that I learned, that there were complications and the doctor decided to actually take away the whole womb because it was a C-section.
Right.
And while in the C-section, there was a decision made to take out the womb for whatever. And that was the real malpractice, because it is counterindicated that you cannot do that when practicing a C-section, as I had understood. I'm not a doctor or a gynecologist or anything, but that's what I knew.
Well, thank you for that, because it's not just curiosity for me, it's narrative life story. And I found it fascinating. You're talking about, like, why as a child, why did God take my mom away? And wondering if within that there was a a feeling of guilt and burden that you took your mom away, that your birth, like if any of that was put on you by your siblings, you know, like, why did you take mom away? You're coming. And luckily your siblings were much older than you, so that hopefully that was never put on you. But the work that I've done with kids, they usually take on stories of importance like that in their own mind about their life. And I wondered if that was a forgiveness opportunity within your own life to not feel in any way responsible for that your mother wasn't there for you.
Exactly, then. Exactly. Yes. I mean, absolutely. I carried with that, let's say, guilty feeling, which is another beauty of the Course in Miracles, you know. Move away from guilt. Oh, yeah, please. Yes. Because I've been guilty since I was born. Because it's inescapable, you see, all of it. And then I remember my father talking about me when he thought I wasn't hearing. Of course, I had, you know, hearing like a German Shepherd. I mean, I could hear miles away. And and I could hear him say, oh, you know, talking to, say, an aunt or somebody, because, you know, my problem, and this, my problem, and aware of my problem. What was his problem? Me. Yes. I was his problem. Because his problem was that he needed to get a mother for me, because not only did he lose his wife. And of course, you know, it's clear by the pictures, because one exasperating thing for me, and you know, being open about it, was the fact that I only knew my mother through a few pictures back then. Many of them black and white, or even, you know, like this brownish colored picture, like so ancient. How could that be? I mean, nobody even cared, you know, to say, hey, this guy needs to see some more pictures of his mother. No, because everybody took their pictures, you know, and it was their secret, their tragedy, their own, you know, kind of cause for their, you know, their personal whatever fantasy. And I couldn't see a great deal of pictures of my mother. Yeah.
And I mean, all of that, like there is that part. And I ask you that because that little piece got left out in the deeper level of form of the true forgiveness of you carrying a burden that you were a problem, that you were the problem, and that, you know, in wanting to feel normal and within that. And it's a lot of focus and that forgiveness, you know, to then projecting it out. And how are you supposed to have a good relationship with a woman when you were a problem that removed a woman? you know, the life. And just, you know, I was so touched, even though I questioned you knowing that Holy Spirit brought you A Course in Miracles, but then you said by chance you found that you were a good singer was singing in English. I don't think any of your path was by chance. But very, very touched that you know, your singing of the Frank Sinatra song, I Did It My Way. My father played that song over and over and over and over again to his passing. And we all sang it, went on Zoom. He took his last breath and gathered us on Zoom. And we all sang laughing, you know, you did it your way. Yes, you did. But the feeling that you finally got to do something that felt like your way, and it was still Spirit. And then even that was taken from you in a COVID. But that it's still Spirit. And the teaching, it seems from this, my perspective, that is so beautiful that you're on, is that it isn't what you find that is your way or your path or you're not the problem anymore. It is truly the constantly knowing that what you say, that where you are is your way. And that's the kind of an essence of what you were talking about, which is journey without distance. No matter how far you go in this life and all the things that happened, you know who you really are inside. And you know what's there with you continuously, which is Spirit. and all of the outside, whether it looks like you're going to, you know, be expressing spirit, you know, through crying the tears of happiness, or you're going to be dealing with a mundane, practical life, it's how you find yourself in it. And that self is the greater self in it. And I'm just, you know, it's such a beautiful, beautiful story.
I do
disagree with one thing you said. You said that in your 50s, the best, I'm quoting you, the best years of my life are going past me. And I will tell you, I'm in my 60s. These are the best years. And I watched my mother when she got to the 70s and she goes, wow, these are the best years. And then she got to the 80s and they're not gone. Your best years are today in that journey without distance. It's today. And that's when you hold that button down continuously. That's what you get to experience more and more, no matter what's going on. And that is the challenge. I'm not saying that's easy. It should be the easiest thing there is, obviously, but it's really one of the hardest. And, And I think you're in a beautiful story that is not yet over for you, being free of some of the things that you're still carrying as burdens.
Correct.
No, you're still
thank you.
In the depths
thank
of
so
this
much.
Coursework. Oh, of course. I mean, I'm very touched by your dedication and commitment to knowing what feels right amidst the challenges. And it's thank you for sharing that with us.
Oh, thank you. And your insights are so not only beautiful, but they come in a very appropriate time. So I value and treasure them very, very much. Very much. Well, thank you, Tam.
Well, the other thing too is like I just see you as your own Mexican crooner. The type of songs, the fact that you use crooner is such a beautiful symbol. For me to hear of your own being, you're always crooning for that love.
And yeah, correct.
For what's been lost, and you're crooning for actually yourself. And doesn't matter if you're doing it professionally or not professionally, it's in your heart. And I don't care what goes on with COVID or elsewise. Just keep singing.
Yes.
And that cannot be taken away from you.
Exactly. Right.
And I think you are that one person that can wake up. You know, that's you within your own self. And croon away for it, because it will come to you.
Thank you. Yes, yeah. Of course it will. I mean, one of the things I also love about the course is when it refers to, I don't know if you like these terms, I'm sure you do, the great rays of light, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Isn't that gorgeously beautiful? So, you know, those just reading that just heightens my spirit, just reading that that's, I guess, what one can feel, right? When true happiness, because that is the purpose of the course as well, right? Happiness and joy.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I want to acquire happiness and joy. I want to be like that. And it's just a question of holding that button down. It's just a question of living in a forgiveness mode. Yeah. For everything. And then when you look at the word atonement and say, well, that's the forgiveness of forgivenesses, right? Is that the way I understand it? Do I understand correctly?
No, it's at one moment. I mean, it truly is. And it's, you know, there's something beautiful about that, remembering you are at one. And, you know, I just can't applaud enough. Your crooning is your path within your own being.
Thank you.
That love and that desire for that state. So.
Yeah.
Well,
if you,
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
It's funny, the second and third definitions of, I was looking up croon, is one of them is to sing something popular or a lullaby. And I was like, interesting. Mm-hmm. It's like a lullaby that's mentioned. But it was kind of
a lullaby you get for your mom is your crooning.
Yeah.
And even when you say, you know, mom is not here, but you are, mom is here all along, you know, in course terminology, and there is no death. Mom never left.
Exactly.
Went back to her, and she never left. And there again is the journey without distance.
Exactly. Right. Yeah.
So. Well, Matt, you have a great visual you've given us for the forgiveness button. Is there anything else you do when you get caught in a state of just total ego backlash where it feels real and the weight and the heaviness just seems overwhelming? Is there anything you do to kind of get back on track that you find helpful?
Well, that's an excellent question. You know, what I do, Matt, is I look for something to do. I probably don't always find it, but I look for it. I just rebel myself against that, and I do take it to that altar. You know, there are things the Course says, take it to the Holy Spirit's altar and put it there. Yeah, this is the time. This is the time that's the resource. Right?
Yeah,
I've been also certified as a amongst other things I've done with my life, my practical life. I've been certified as a coach by a couple of U.S. Coaches, et cetera. And there's this term about being so resourceful, right? You have to be resourceful in this world. Yeah, what are your resources? My resource is at the very last is either look for it, either look for a bit of meditation, either look for if I have the book around me, but I'm not always successful at that because I don't think that it's something like, you know, some people say, just open it up in the page and it'll tell you exactly what you want to read. No, it's not fantasy like that. It's truth, what I'm looking for. It's really truth that really settles. And I just keep it there. You know, I remember that when I got stuck, and this goes back to your question, Tom, about the complexity of the language. At times, you know, reading my lesson at night, I used to do a lesson, and I used to do two or three pages of the textbook. And at times I just couldn't understand. Either I was tired or even whatever. So I used to pray, and my very simple prayer was, please, God, let just the fact that I'm pronouncing these words come into wherever they need to be. Just by the mere fact that I'm reading this, let it be the merit enough so that they'll change me. Because I'm not understanding, not at a rational level, not always, not 100%. And I have to keep going because I can't be stuck in these three phrases but that was my prayer. Just keep it simple and just go to the altar and just put that issue there and see what happens.
Well, sorry, I have to jump in and disagree again about something, but it's less a disagreement than an inclusion. I think there are many ways to find truth. And I'm one of those people who can open the book or choose to open the book sometimes and get a message, because I think every single word in this book is truth. So when I'm in need and I'm in a kind of ego storm and my mind has taken over, and I open the book to something, it's always so applicable, because any page is applicable, but it does, I give it permission to talk to me specifically at that moment. And I mean, very quickly, recently, I was going to help a woman who was passing, transitioning, old word dying, but there is no death in this. And you know, my partner said, open, you know, let's do our lesson before you go. And so we did a lesson, and it was lesson 95. And it's the short version. My paraphrase is, you know, I am one with my creator. And anyway, I get to this person's home. I didn't know anyone there. and just to help, because she was a Course in Miracles student, and I was found and asked to kind of be there in her transitioning. And when I got there, you know, it became obvious none of her kids were Course in Miracles students, but she had been, and she was, you know, in and out of consciousness, mostly out, didn't speak much at all anymore. And I said to her daughter, one of her daughters, I think she might want to have something read from the Course. And the woman said, well, what should I do? And I said to her, open any page and let's see where you are and just read. And she opened the page to lesson 95 and that exact statement. And she started weeping. She goes, oh, this is so appropriate for now. And it was appropriate for me too. At that moment, and she started saying, my mother always told me, go through life and open any book to any page and it will give you an answer. So it's not necessarily fantasy. If you infuse that you're looking for the truth, spirit will answer you in a million different ways if you're open to it. And so that's not to say that how you do it too is not completely correct, with your mind thinking, okay, I want truth. Don't give me the fantasy of opening or magic to opening any page. I'm going to find it through the union of my intellect, my request, and my prayer.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you, Tam, because that's very refreshing. This experience you shared is so enlightening and refreshing. And I'll continue doing it because I have done it. I have opened the book in any page and I can't recall a particular story. I'll continue doing it because it just resonates.
Do it however you want. I just don't want other people to feel that their way is wrong. That there's only one way to hear truth and to experience it. And spirit loves to play. So when she opened that book to that page, I was internally going, thank you. You've just, made me see. I'm here. We're all one. It was a reminder.
Yeah. Beautiful. Yeah. Beautiful.
Well, Matt, we've come to the part of the interview where we ask you your favorite comfort food. You've got a big palate to choose from in Mexico. So let's hear it.
Oh, well, that's an interesting one. Tocayo. That's an interesting one because Mexico offers such a diversity in foods. I mean, it's just wonderful. Mexico is a very complex land geography, and it has many downsides, but it has upsides like so gorgeously beautiful, and gastronomy is one of them. So my favorite comfort food, and I knew you'd ask this, so yeah, because I've heard you ask it in other podcasts. My favorite comfort food is taco al pastor. Have you guys had that taco al pastor?
I have had that. Yes, very good.
What's
the first word? Taco al pastor.
Taco al pastor.
Taco. It's like Taco Bell.
Yeah. Got a taco. What is it?
Well, it's a well. Maybe you've seen it, the Greek type gyros, I think they're called, right? That yes. you have a something like a flour tortilla, and then you have this beef that's kind of piled up, and it has a stick that holds every fillet together. So there's a flame that is cooking the sides of that. So it's something like a cylinder going round and round, and the flames hitting one part of the cylinder at the time. So the taco master who's doing this for you takes the tortilla on his left hand, has a very, very sharp knife and long knife on the right hand. So dependent on how cooked you want your taco al pastor, he will cut a very thin slice of several layers of those pork steaks, put it in the tortilla, and on top of that cylinder, there's a piece of pineapple. So the artistry, if you like, of the taco master is he will do that instantly: the tortilla, the knife, the meat, And then up he goes with his hand and chops off a bit of pineapple that hits your taco. And on top of that, he will spray cilantro and chopped onion. And there's, of course, green or red salsa to put on it. And boy, is that delicious. That is my favorite comfort food.
I'm so hungry right now. I can't believe it. Okay.
I hope I didn't make you hungry by detailed description.
That was very detailed. That was very detailed. That was great. Yeah, it does look just kind of like a cutting like a gyro or like a shawarma off this like spinning meat. It's really good. I forgot about that pineapple part, but yes, wonderful description, Matt. Very good. Well, thanks so much for coming on Miracle Voices, Matt, and sharing your miracle voice. What a touching story you have. And I'm sure it helped a lot of people, help me. And I can't wait to get this published out there to everybody today.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Tam, Matt. This has become most valuable and enlightening, and I so much thank you for it. And if you ever come around this geography, let me be the one who show you which are the best tacos al pastor. I'll make sure of that.
That's a deal.
Okay.
Thanks, Matt. Thanks so much for listening today. Please subscribe to Miracle Voices by hitting the subscribe button on your podcast app. If you are enjoying these conversations, please consider leaving us a review on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or whatever podcast app you use. And lastly, please visit us at miraclevoices.org and join our newsletter so we can stay connected. Until the next podcast, I want to leave you with my favorite course quote, "When you want only love, you will see nothing else."